Great Debaters Contest is brought to you by Safaricom M-Pesa.
This is the capital city, and get ready for a capital debate. We're in Nairobi region for the Great Debaters Contest, Austin Nyambok.
I am Mariam Bishar, and we have Nairobi powerhouses, Strathmore School and State House Girls debating today. They are asking whether media censorship by the government is necessary to enhance national security. Proposal number one, you have 3 minutes.
Ladies and gentlemen, I have news for you. Al-Shabaab watches television. Shock, right? The motion states that media censorship by the government is necessary to enhance national security. So we need to ask ourselves, what is this national security that we're talking about? National security is the idea or the practice of the government of protecting its citizens from national crises. What a national crisis? It can be anything from internal attacks to external attacks to even pandemics to natural disasters. So, what do I mean by necessary? Let's use synonyms for a bit here. By necessary, we can also replace it with bottom line, or compulsory, or mandatory, or even fundamental. Now, let's discuss censorship just a bit more, because I feel at this point it's necessary for us to state the fact that we don't mean complete censorship. We don't mean total censorship. You see, censorship is the act of suppressing information, in this case, which may be found to be questionable or objectionable in any terms, for instance, political terms or military terms or even moral terms. National security, as we have established, is the responsibility of the government. It doesn't mean that the government censors every single thing that its media produces, including its social, the social media of the people in its country. It means that it holds back that which endangers national security or lets go of that which also enhances national security. You see, censorship isn't just holding back, it's also knowing when to let go. For instance, Ebola. There was an outbreak of Ebola in Western Africa last year, and the governments were wise enough to let people know. What did this do? This meant that, number one, people would know not to come into the country, otherwise they'd get Ebola themselves, and they also know that this is a cry for help. People realize that there's a need to find a cure for Ebola, and the problem was averted. But here's a situation in which we needed censorship. September 21st, 2013, Westgate. When, like I mentioned, Al-Shabaab watched TV when they were inside Westgate, shooting people. They just watched the TVs in Nakumatt, and they knew exactly where KDF was. They didn't have to run and hide. They knew exactly where to go. You see, if the government had decided that we shouldn't air this material, then it should have been so easy to get rid of the Al-Shabaab in Westgate. But remember, the media are not experts at this. They shouldn't be trusted with national security. Thank you.
Opposition, we're ready for your opening remarks. You have 3 minutes.
The government should not blame the media for its failures. Is the media responsible for the insecurity being faced in the country? Shelmith Washira from State House Girls High School, opposing the motion that media censorship by the government is necessary to enhance national security. Is this media relaying information to us about the Westgate attack, the Garissa attack, to inform the terrorists? No, they are making us more aware of what is happening. If you personally did not see this bloody image, if you did not see these people crying, would you know the pain they're facing? If you would not have the humanity to put yourself in their shoes, would you help the government in combating terrorism? We do not need the government to censor the media. The media personnel are responsible on their own. I do remember in 2007, Walter Mungare, as you know him, Nyambane, did convey a meeting of all the media personnel. This was when our leaders were fighting. Why were they fighting? For the leading positions. He said that if these footages were released to the people, it would set the country ablaze. And as a result, this information was not given to the people. If it were given, we would be at a worse position, because without the information, Kenya wallowed into a deep pool of bloodshed. So, are you trying to tell me that Walter Mungare, as one of the pioneers of peace in this country, needs to be censored by the government so that he can know what is right and what is not? The same way the government cannot come into my home, into my house, and tell me the amount of food I can eat, they have no right to tell me the right of information I am exposed to. Information is power. An opinion poll carried out in the year 2011 in Paraguay made the people realize that 87% of the total population of Paraguay wanted their media to be free of the government censorship. What's the first thing you think of when you hear of Iran? What's the first thing you think of when you hear of Egypt, Eritrea? All these are countries where government censorship on the media is intense. And what common thing do they have? War, political instability. We want this for our nation. Clearly, this is a policy that is not working. What makes you think, after these countries adopting censorship in Kenya, if we did adopt this, would you think would it be effective? The media, therefore, the country adopting censorship, it would only reflect a society's lack of confidence. And as a proud Kenyan, a proud member of this world, I would never want to be deemed as lack of confidence. Thank you.
We'll hear rebuttals now. Strathmore School, you have 3 minutes.
Well, quite frankly, I do not have... Well, I actually do have a lot to rebut. My friend here says that what should the government come and do and tell you in your own house how much food you should eat? But I am a history student, and if my history serves me well, which I do believe it does, it tells me that if any freedom right, whatever it is, contradicts the fundamental right to life, I think that right should be restricted. And now, by the way, Eritrea is not at war. Are you trying to say that the Arab Spring was caused by media censorship? I don't believe so, that if you censor Teletubbies or perhaps any other thing on YouTube, people will start fighting. Not really. Now, the media personnel are quite responsible. If you say that they're not, they're the ones airing this media. And as Valiant Wayaki said, they were watching it. We do not say that you censor everything. We do not want a totalitarian state. We want a place where there is enough censorship. Because if you censor the strategies of the army, then the Al-Shabaab will not know which direction the army is coming from. That's what the media showed, which direction the army was entering. Even Somalia and Westgate. Boom, boom, shakar, tutu, boom. Those are some of the sounds we hear in a chemistry lesson at Strathmore. Well, after smelling ammonia, of course. Now, our teacher is quite, it's quite the nut. But those are also the same sounds you heard, people heard in World War II, when people were being hacked to death. But people did not win World War II by just sitting down and laying on their backs. No, World War II was won by an atomic bomb. And that atomic bomb, for example, if our opponents, what they're saying is that if everyone knew how to make an atomic bomb, do you think that this country will be safe right now? Perhaps we would still be slaves to Hitler. Perhaps he would have continued enslaving Europe. Perhaps we would not be here today. Can you imagine that gory sight of a 15-year-old watching on YouTube how to make a nuclear bomb, just brooding over there? Yes, I can see how to make this bomb. I don't think I want to be in that type of society. Now, let's talk about two ladies from Britain. Hello, Governor. That's what you'd hear probably in London as you're walking across. But these girls left a first world country. They left a country where everything was in good measure and in good provisions to join ISIL. Well, they had no connection with people who could tell them, yo, or you, please come join ISIL, please come join the attack. No, they saw it from the media. Perhaps if this media had been censored, those girls would not have lost their lives in Syria. I can imagine if I ever had a daughter, which God knows I want to, I wouldn't want her to die, to go and fight for a senseless cause. I don't want that. Do you? Thank you.
Statehouse girls, you have 3 minutes for a rebuttal.
As they say, a sharp tongue does not mean you have a sharp kin. If I may correct my opponents, the two opponents, in fact, the first one saying that censorship is about holding. I seek to correct you that censorship is not about the when information is held or held back or let go. It is entirely about the what of information. I mean the content. Again, Eritrea, we need to get our facts right. In Eritrea, the president, by the name President Honorable Isaiah, fully controls the media. Why are you lying to us? The freedom of the media is the long struggle, is the result of a long struggle. I mean, our country has a mission and a vision 2030. We do not want to go back to the draconia, the retrogressive era. We consider the media, the free media, as the most important institute of the civilian society. It is the only means to control the authorities. I mean, it's only the media independent from the state, which is the effective tool to the democratic society. You see, you may give an example that the media, which is not controlled, if not controlled by the government, that it may give us irrelevant information about the national security. Well, in Turkey, in the year 2011, they were censoring the media, and there was a major Kurdish conflict going on to the east of the country. Instead, the people in Istanbul were viewing about movies of penguins. How relevant is that? How gullible can we get in terms of our media? I mean, we should get serious. We need the liberty of business. We need liberty of the words and everyone's right in our country. That can only happen under the effective rule and power of the media. You see, we are all united under one principle, the Constitution. In Article 33.2, it states that the freedom of all types of media is guaranteed, but not to an extent that it may express hate speech. The government is a subject to the Constitution. Why should we go against our Constitution? As I conclude, wisdom is the right use of knowledge. To know is not to be wise. We are all aware that the government is there for the welfare of the society. But do we really know what the government is carrying out? I mean, do we really know the real mandate of the government? Honestly, a thought is not a suggestion. A suggestion is not a point to consider. But cementing all this with logics and reasoning, we can come up and it gives you a remedy. This motion is not a solution. It's not a solution, it's giving us a suggestion. Therefore, we should go for the solutions and not suggestions. Thank you.
M-Pesa is not a mobile banking service, but it's a mobile transfer service. That's why I like M-Pesa, because I can send money to my girlfriend, send money to my friend when he has a problem.
Take part in the M-Challenge by sending your short song, rap or poem about Safaricom M-Pesa on WhatsApp, and you could win 1,000 shillings in Safaricom airtime.
Proposition have been asked, wasn't censorship necessary during, for example, the Arab Spring, where most messages were spread through social media? And the opposition have been asked, how does sympathy for victims of terrorism contribute to national security? Proposal number 3, you have 3 minutes.
Indeed, we have a good day with us. Like to start by thanking you for your question. Indeed, we agree that censorship was not required then. But we still need to understand that censorship is important to enhance national security. Our opponents, you asked for a remedy, and here I am. My name is Jeremy Matayo from Strathmore School. And we need to understand, Many things, many people have been lost due to one thing: absence of censorship. Let me remind you, not so long ago, Charlie Hebdo magazine, 12 cartoonists and editors lost their lives because they sent out the wrong information. Now imagine, of course they had editors who would have removed that information. But imagine if the government stepped in. The duty of every government is to ensure that there's equality for every religion, race, and community. And by not, or rather by insulting a certain religion, their lives were lost. But if the government had stepped in, I think these people would be here. Their creativity would still be with us. I'd like to bring to your attention that censorship by the government would actually stop hate speech. I'd like to remind you of a famous member of parliament here in Kenya, known by the name Moses Kuria. He was having what we would say a machete talk, or a panga talk in native language of Swahili, inciting members of a certain community to attack others. Now, if the government steps in, of course, we trust the people we elect. Choices come with consequences. I believe so. Moses Kuria is being sought after by many communities right now. But if the government stepped in, that information would not have reached me, would not have reached my mother, who's from a different place. And I would still be at peace knowing that someone somewhere does not like me, does not want to kill me, because I'm from somewhere else. Censorship ensures that we are going on well. Cohesion, integration, peace, love, national values, patriotism by the government. It is their duty, it is their role. Ladies and gentlemen, time is up. Thank you.
Opposition, we're ready for you to respond. You have 3 minutes.
Sammy Teresia from State House Girls High School, standing to oppose the motion that states media censorship by the government is necessary to enhance national security. It is totally beyond me why you would have news for us if it actually is not news in the first place. I believe our audience are intellectuals and quite informed, or is it not? Now, your history does serve you well, but the Constitution does serve us better. It is clearly stated in Chapter 4 of the Constitution that there are limitations to the freedom of life. For instance, national security in this case. What makes you think that the only source of information for the terrorists will be the media? You will be surprised. In Egypt, according to the Daily Nation of July 3rd, there is a rising jihadist insurgency, which is a major threat to the president. And, mind you, media is censored in this country. I will now answer my question. I am sorry, that was too burning. I had to respond. The question was, sympathy, how does it contribute to national security? What makes us human, I ask? Is it what the short hair that I wear? Or is it the beautiful uniform you have on? No, it is everything that composes or rather encompasses of a human person. That's dignity, that's decorum, that is what you stand for, your principles, your values, and so on. It is what I believe in. It is the emotions that I have every day. If you cannot feel sympathy, you are basically not human. Sympathy will bring us together. It is by understanding the pain these people go through that we will be unified as a country. And national integration does prevent national insecurity. Censorship will not stop hate speech. It will stop the broadcasting of hate speech. Just because the media does not look at me, for example, the camera, and air what I feel on KBC doesn't mean that I won't have the liberty to say it once I'm out there. You do trust your politicians, but are they trustworthy? Those are two very different questions. You know not. It is true. It is okay. Ignorance is bliss, but it's a temporal, I repeat, it's a temporal solace sought by those who are afraid to face the truth. Yes, I do have a pencil in my head. And yes, I do aspire to have an afro one day, but we will make do with what we have. This is what we do with the media. We are putting them at the back of our minds, ignoring every single thing that they can do when we have them in our hands, and pretending that they play no role. They play no role in our society currently. When we ignore, it doesn't mean they don't exist. There is so much you can do with a pen. Yes, it is broken. The media is not perfect. But yes, it can serve the purpose just as well. The media can work hand in hand with the government, which according to the analogy is me, to serve the purpose for the common good. The media does not have to be censored to enhance national security. All you have to do, all we have to do, is to intertwine and integrate as one. Thank you.
Strathmore School, you have 1 minute for your final submission.
My name is Valiant Wayaki, and I just have to say this. We do not disagree that the media has no role. In fact, we agree that it's very important to this society. So important, in fact, that we have to protect ourselves. You see, this thing called the media is powerful. We give it a lot of power. It shapes our thoughts and our emotions, which apparently is what makes us human. So why are we letting it instruct us in the wrong way? Now, forgive my undressing, but I just wanted to show you this band. This is a band that I'm wearing because I love my country. Another thing that I love is my life. Now, would I prefer to have information, but let the having of that information lead to my death? I mean, there's information that will cause my death. To say it again, Westgate. If the military tactics for entering Somalia were known, then surely that enhances Al-Shabaab's offensive against my life. So, right to information, right to life, right to life. Thank you.
State House girls, you also have a minute.
This motion provides the right motive, but the wrong solution. Only cowards will seek to lay their blame, insufficiencies, inadequacies, their shortcomings, their failures, and their insufficiency on someone or something just because they deem it fit. Is our government a coward? Because if it is, that means by merit of association, we also are cowards. And I believe no one would want to be called, or rather even come to terms with the fact that they could be a coward. When you tether a goat, do not expect it to eat beyond its radius. Now, when, and also do not be shocked when it becomes aggravated and vicious and breaks free, wreaking havoc all around. When we gag, and muzzle the media, this is what is bound to happen. The media is an intermediary between the people and the government. When there is unrest and when there's unrest in the media, we will have to bear the dire consequences. Are we ready to live in such a society? Because I know I am not.
Valiant, again, good to see you. You started this off very well. I love your calmness. You know, you don't shout. You're very calm. Also very well read. James Mwangi, when you make reference to history, you get me, because I am a believer in understanding history to define where we are today. And so you take us back, and that was really, really good. Of course, I love your sense of humor as well, and the fact that you're able to command audience attention. I think the newest addition to the team is Matayo, and good to see you. You respond to the question really well. You talk about how media censorship would lead to hate speech. And I think I like the fact that you're using a very relevant example that everybody's talking about today. You know, the MP Moses Kuria and what should be done about some of the statements that he made. I think my disappointment was I was hoping that you'd make reference to the Constitution and the various articles in the Constitution. Article 33, the freedom of expression. Article 34, freedom of the media. Article 35, access to information. And where the motion places those particular articles with regards to what you were saying. And, you know, I have known you guys to do very good research. And I was a little disappointed there. But overall, good job.
State House girls, Shelmith, good examples. I love the fact that you take us across Egypt, Eritrea, and of course you also gave the example of, I think the Eritrea one was the one that was cross-examined a bit, but that was good. We have relevant examples that have shown this happening. Good research, but to Valiant and Shelmith, time utilization, you guys are going across the time given, you know, aboard. I mean, time aboard. I mean, so you need to be careful about that. Sigal, Good attempt. I love your fair cross-examination. But I think now with more exercise as well, you would make a better cross-examiner and a great speaker. I don't know whether you had some stage fright. I sensed it. I could hear it in your voice a bit. But I think you will. It's something that you can work on and your confidence will be on another level. Okay? Sammy, I also didn't write anything for you. You're just like Jesse. Excellent. That was awesome. You know, the summation that you came to give. And of course, I love the fact that you speak very fast. I thought it would be a disadvantage. But you took that to your advantage. And you could give a lot of points. And of course, you know, manage to utilize your time to the advantage of your team. All the best to the two teams. I think you did a fair job. Okay.
State House Girls High School. The judges awarded you 72%. Strathmore School, the judges awarded you 74.6%. You are our winners for the debate.
Bravo to Strathmore School, and of course that was a very good job by State House Girls. We want to thank all of you for watching and for continuously supporting us. Of course, we also like to thank our sponsors, Safaricom M-Pesa and KBC Channel 1 for carrying our content. Be sure to follow us on Twitter at Great Debaters EA, and we're on all other social media platforms as well. I have been your host, Mariam Bishar.
And I am Austin Yumbok. Thanks for watching.
The Great Debaters Contest was brought to you by Safaricom M-Pesa.